It is absolutely thrilling to be here with you and to be able to talk to you about some of the work I've been doing, because a lot of what I'm talking about has to do with things that are happening in America that are affecting the whole world. And I feel like those of us who are concerned about what's happening in America and have learned from it should help others understand what we've learned to try to help you deal with it. I will be talking from an American perspective. Some of the things I say may be more relevant than others, but from the work that I've done in Belfast and in Northern Ireland and a little bit of work I have done in Dublin, my sense is a lot of what I'm talking about as concerns in the U.S. are going to be very relevant for you too. I want to start with one word of warning, and that is everything's been very upbeat so far, and what I'm going to talk about is pretty depressing. And when I give talks in the States, I often tell people if they have to leave in the middle, they may not want to stay, because the second half is when we talk about what to do. But and that often really kind of empowers you to deal with the terrible, with the depressing things you've heard about, and gives you ideas about ways you can really help make it better. I feel like you need the lens to understand the problems, to connect the dots of various things you've been experiencing with children and think about how they all work together, because it empowers you more to make more holistic decisions about what to do. And the last comment before lunch about why this particular dancing group was chosen, I think is a perfect lead-in to what I'm going to be talking about. When I say so sexy so soon, think for a minute about what am I talking about? What do you think of when you heard that was the title of the talk? Is there anyone who's in the front half of the room probably, who's willing to just share what's something that you think of? So sexy, so soon. Clothes, the kinds of sexualized clothes that are here for girls. Anyone else? Just raise your hand and I'll call on you. Yes. Dance, the kind of dancing that we heard about. Anything else? Makeup, the kind of makeup. What age do kids start using makeup here?
Hair.
Hair, the kinds of what's happening with their hair. Anything else?
Claire's accessories.
Say that again?
Claire's accessories. That's
a shop that has special accessories.
Okay,
I've got to see that shop. Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, so what I'm going to talk about first is, when I say so sexy so soon, what am I talking about and how did it get to be like that? And secondly, some of the impact that I see it having on children, and then what we can do about it. First of all, we need to think about the screens everywhere. That are starting from, there's a huge push in the US anyway on screens for babies, telling parents this is a good way to be with your children, playing with the screen. It's then what they see on the screen, which is female characters, Bratz and Barbie and Princess and Hannah Montana, and the kind of content that they're seeing when they're glued to the screen. Is that true here too? Do you have these things? And it's growing. Cell phones are the new biggest thing for young children, starting with young children. And so much of what they're seeing is focusing on sexiness and appearance for girls. And the Bratz dolls I know you have here. Have any of you seen Bratz, girls play with Bratz dolls? What do they do?
Put on American accents.
I just heard that today for the first time. I didn't know that happened, so it's how they... So they're learning something about culture. We should be happy about that. Anything else they do when they play with them? Dress them and undress them, and dress them and undress them. Anything else? I've heard of fashion shows. I've heard of going shopping. I've heard of going on dates. But every girl in every country I've talked in, including the U.S., that's what they do with them. And in fact, most of what they're doing, I don't call play, because it's just imitating. They're being robots doing what the doll is telling them to do, which is dress them and make them look pretty. It's not bringing in their own ideas, their own experiences. It's just channeling them into very narrow stuff. Now, do you have Sesame Street here? Tickle Me Elmo? Well, here we have Barbie trying to compete with Bratz Dolls, which surpassed Barbie in sales 2 years ago. So what did they do? They joined forces with Sesame Street. Does it surprise anyone that Sesame Street would join forces with Barbie and say, here's it, our product, you know, it's for three-year-olds? Why would Sesame Street do it? First of all, Barbie wants to get brand loyalty at the youngest age possible. All of what I'm talking about is marketers. Marketers research, how does Barbie reclaim its first place position? And in part, one way to do it is to get brand loyalty at the youngest age possible. What better way to do it than to tell parents using their trust in Sesame Street that Barbie's okay for their little three-year-old girls as a plaything, and then putting her in what I call a crotch skirt. Okay, here is someone who's kind of dressed somewhat, you know, her body's developed like a woman, but she's in a crotch skirt. And then the other thing they've done is their life-size Barbie, bling-bling hairstyling Barbie, where you get to fix her hair, it comes with makeup, and you can do it to yourself, too. All the makeup is safe, thinking about the safety issue. Problem with this, anyone? We know from research that when children are make themselves become the object that they're imitating, it has a bigger impact. When they're doing the actions, when it's them, has a bigger effect on them. Do you have Dora the Explorer here?
Yes.
Have you been reading about what's going to happen to Dora Explorer?
No.
Well, here's the news. She's being made into a tween. And there's been a big uproar in the States, but the Dora the Explorer people are thrilled it's getting so much PR, even if it's negative, because it's on people's minds. So she's going to have bleached hair, you know, striped hair. She's going to have sexier clothes, and you're going to be able to buy them. And it really, really worries me when we take someone who, many parents who are concerned about some of the sexualization, and end up instead using Dora because she was much more of an adventurous, she had a much broader range of behaviors and things she did, even though there were dozens of products, which is almost as big a problem as the sexiness. But at least she was providing a wider range of behaviors for girls than what they do with Bratz dolls. And now they're going to turn her into someone who's like the Bratz dolls. And then beyond play, you all know about Hannah Montana?
Yeah.
Hannah Montana, who, again, I heard rumors, I'd never seen the figures, that Hannah Montana surpassed Bratz in sales this past December holiday season. But then, do you all know about these pictures she posed in, that Miley Cyrus posed in? Annie Leibovitz, the photographer, took these pictures. Do you all know who the man she's draped over is? It's her father. If you didn't know it was her father, what would you think? Boyfriend, here she is, a 14-year-old, draped over her father. And this is the big role model for girls ages 4 and up, and they're learning this is what you're supposed to do. I've started working with more groups who are concerned about child sexual abuse, who are really concerned about how this is seasoning girls to think being cool to men, being sexy with men, especially girls who are at risk for abuse, are going to see men's, you know, being attracted to them and as something that's desirable. In the U.S., when there was an uproar about this, the media tried to frame it as, is it art or isn't it? And when media came to me to talk about it, and that's how they wanted me to talk about it, and I refused, because for me the issue is, this is the biggest role model for girls in the U.S. and many other parts of the world. And when she starts doing things, kids think it's for them. And is that okay for their role model to do things like this? And what impact does it have? One of our other big toy companies, do you know about the Pussycat Doll group? It's amazing how international so much of this stuff is. Hasbro, who's the big competitor with the people who make Barbie dolls, was trying to get in on the market, and they were going to make Pussycat Doll dolls for girls ages 7 and up. And a group that I'm a founder of called Campaign for Commercial Free Childhood, and I'll show you the website at the end, actually launched a protest with our 10,000, I think it's now 15,000 members of our listserv, And we did a big press release and did a lot of media about how this was an out. It was going to be a line of clothes, a line of dolls, and a line of other products. And the third day of the campaign, after there was an article in the New York Times, Hasbro called the Campaign for Commercial Free Childhood and said they were withdrawing the dolls. They would not be released. And that was 2 years ago, 3 years ago now, and they have not released them. So one of the themes I want to bring to you today is think about how to cause trouble. Think about how, as professionals and parents, many of you, in your big ways and in your little ways, you can make it harder for this stuff to go on. Because in part it's happened because the corporations have control over the airwaves, have control over the messages, and we need to find ways to have a voice too, as the people who are trained to understand what's good for children. In the US, we had Club Libby Lou's in the upscale shopping malls around the country. And little girls could go, say, for their birthday party with their friends and get makeovers. And they were taught how to wiggle down the runway to be like real models. And they got to choose what they were going to wear. And the birthday girl got a tape of the of her fifth birthday party. And the girls, as party favors, got photographs of themselves where they were shown how to do pinup poses. One good thing I can tell you about the crashing economy is that Club Libby Lou closed in the US last month. So that was a good thing, but there are many others, and I actually was just contacted by a reporter in France who's doing a story about these kinds of things in France who wanted to talk, so it's not only the U.S. on that one either. And then we have spas for little girls, where they can go for their makeover. I talked to a reporter recently in Florida who said she went to a spa that had just opened for girls, and they advertise it for girls ages 4 and up, but when she went, there was a 2-year-old. So one of the questions we need to ask, there's been a lot of more concern in the US anyway about adolescents and young and tweens and the kind of sexual behavior that goes on with kids, say, ages 10 or 11 and up. But people aren't asking, where did it come from? It's kind of like it magically appeared when they were adolescents, that the kinds of sexual behavior, like we talk about friends with benefits, and hooking up for the night without relationship, that being involved in sex without any connection, with very young, happening with young tweens. And no one's talking about how did they get there and what's happening. And in fact, my argument is it's happening to sell kids things. And yet when kids are young and parents do something where their kids look cute, they say, well, their kids don't understand what's going on. But the fact is, it's part of a progression where kids learn how they look determines their value. It's what grown-ups think is cute when they're very young. And it objectifies them. It turns that how you look, not what you do, becomes really important. So the cumulative effect as kids get older and developmentally more sophisticated, you know, the foundation has been laid to build onto. And then we have things like High School Musical bra and panty sets. This was in Walmart. Do you have Walmart here yet? Be happy. But I'm sure there are other... Okay, so you have other versions. Okay, but this is a bra and panty set. There were many versions. You know, kids are arguing with their parents for them. I talked to a teacher of 5-year-olds who this year said she'd never dealt with before. Two girls came to school with bikini underpants at 5. And now all the kids are nagging their parents for them. And now almost all the girls wear bikini underpants. And then you say, well, why don't the parents just say no? And I'll get to that. Parents certainly can say no better than they have been, but it's not going to solve the problem. And you may be interested to know, this summer, anyway, in the U.S., there's going to be a Britney Spears line of clothing. You all know Britney Spears? And the idea is that she, you know, you can see the pose they're going to, you know, have the kind of model they're promising girls if they wear these clothes, the role model they're providing. So what about boys? I didn't make up this shirt, a pimp, the Pimp Squad, or I'm a Chick Magnet. They're T-shirts like that for little boys. But they're also starting from babies. They're being taught, you know, what it means to be a boy before they even understand what it means. But it's grown-ups seeing that are going to be reacting. But what boys are being taught is violence, violence, violence. These Hulk hands linked to the movie were one of the 10 best toys of the year award from the Toy Manufacturers of America a few years ago. Anyone have any idea why? It sold really well. That, you know, they get rewarded for selling well. Has anyone ever tried on these? Because I have. And they really are, it's really fun to hit with them, but they're not a toy. There's only one thing you can do, which is hit. And one thing I want to say, I may show you things that are like things you've bought for your children or whatever, and no one can be pure in this process. I'm not going to advocate perfection at the end when I think about what to do, because no, you know, everyone's going to get involved in it in some way. But kids wake up with Hulk on their mind or Star Wars or whatever's the big thing at the moment. They go to school with the lunch boxes, and in fact, I was in Cape Town, South Africa in March, and went to some preschools in some of the poorest townships where kids were living in one-room tin huts. They had electricity recently added, and so now the one luxury item is a TV. And there were a few kids where their most cherished possession was their, the biggest thing for boys there right now was professional wrestling was their professional wrestling lunchbox or T-shirt. And for girls, it was their Hannah Montana, you know, lunchbox. Now, all of this didn't come about magically. A lot of people are surprised to know, in the middle 80s, in the US, during the deregulation era, children's television and advertising were deregulated. We had less regulation than any other industrialized country up to that point, but it's when it became possible to make a TV show that had products that replicated everything you saw on the screen. Masters of the Universe was the first huge success. After that, He-Man. Then Action Man, Transformers, Power Rangers. Those TV shows would not have been made if they couldn't have hundreds of products linked to the show. Before that, there was a limit on the number of advertising minutes there could be per hour on children's programming. And the Federal Communications Commission ruled that marketing a whole line of toys with a show constituted a program-length commercial. Therefore, it violated the advertising minutes. And it was after deregulation that when I was going around talking to teachers around issues of violence in children's lives, they started asking about war play. And they started saying, well, how does war play fit into kids' understanding of violence? And I said, what do you mean? And a teacher would say, I've taught for 10 years or I've taught for 20 years, and war play wasn't that big an issue in my classroom. If kids started you pretending to use guns, I'd say no guns here. It wasn't a big issue. And now kids are obsessed with it. And I have guerrilla wars going on in my classroom where kids are sneaking around, turning a biscuit, you know, they'll bite into a biscuit or cracker and start using it like a gun. And they, when you go over, they say, oh, no, 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 it's not a gun, it's the letter L. So at least they're learning their alphabet. But they were very much, and teachers wanted to know what was going on. And it turned out 8 of the 10 best-selling toys were linked to TV shows, and all but one of them were violent. And that's the toys kids were using. Now, it's not just that they were violent. They were highly realistic replicas of what kids had seen on the screen. They could only do one thing. They said, when you play, you imitate what you've seen. And kids' play got narrower and narrower and narrower. So it wasn't just that kids were watching more screens, the screens were getting bigger in their lives. But then when they played, they had toys that programmed their play. And then I'm not going to go into this except to say, you know, very quickly, you know, the kinds of violence we're talking about leads to, you know, really graphic violence. And in this case, I'm sure you have Grand Theft Auto here. Does anyone know what happens in this to women? There's a prostitute is picked up. You see almost the full sex act. with all the sex sounds, and at the end, the man pays her, she gets out of the car, you choose your weapon, and you batter her to death, and you see the blood pouring out, and he drives away. Did you know that? So we need to know what kids are involved with, but the linking of violence and sex is happening more and more. Professional wrestling is another place where it happens. And thinking about, as kids get older, what it's telling kids is really important. And then we have just, with deregulation came huge gender divisions again. The idea that boys are channeled into the most extreme violence and girls are channeled into increasing sexiness. Now, do you know, I mentioned the TV shows that became popular for boys. They always had a harder time marketing to girls. Care Bears and My Little Pony were the two big ones for girls, but they never were as successful as the boys' things. And in part, they couldn't find the hook, and gradually sexiness became the hook. And Disney's one of the great masters of that, starting with Disney Princess and moving on. But with deregulation, we had gender divisions again. All the work in the women's movement in the U.S., which I was involved with, where we tried to encourage a broader range of behaviors for boys and girls, started getting gender divided. And it was for marketing purposes, because kids are looking for definitions, and the more clear-cut you make it, kids are prone to stereotype no matter what we do. But we can help expand the stereotypes or exploit the stereotypes, and in this case, we're exploiting them. So we have a McDonald's Happy Meal with He-Man on two sides of the box and Bratz on the other two sides of the box, so that girls and boys know they don't have anything to do with each other. So that gives you all look sufficiently depressed. And I'm gonna summarize some of the problems that I've alluded to as we went along. I've come to think of what I'm talking about is a clash of cultures. We have the parent societal box. I almost think of kids having two boxes in their head. There's all the things we want to teach them that we think they need to grow up to be happy, fulfilled, contributing members of society. And then there's the pop culture box. All the messages that say, you know, this is what you're supposed to be like if you're a girl, if you're a boy. You need to buy more and more and more. You never have enough. There are always things that will make you happier. That having the right media and watching media and knowing what's on is the most important thing. There's all those messages, and I drew that zigzag line to indicate there's often not many connections between the boxes. You know, that what I've talked about pretty much so far was all in the pop culture box. It's not what we want for kids. It's not why we work with kids, and it's not what we know is good for them. But the media and popular culture box is working really hard for kids to shop. Since deregulation, advertising in the U.S. has gone up 1,000% to marketing, to the amount spent on advertising to children. It's also, kids now control more and more of their parents' money in terms of what they're going to buy. And would you be surprised if I told you marketers actually do research on how to get children to nag their parents to buy things? Would that surprise you? If you think about commercials that you see during children's programming, you almost never see an adult in a positive role. You almost never see an adult, because they want to create premature adolescent rebellions where kids stop listening to adults at younger and younger ages. There are real efforts to undermine our efforts to parent and teach and educate children. So the box is separate, and one of the things we need to think about is how to connect and know more about the pop culture box. We often think about the content, and that's mostly what I've talked about so far, but the way children interact with the world has become something that's really important to think about as well. I've called it remote control childhood. The fact that children, when they're glued to a screen, we all know kids are concrete learners. The more they interact with the world themselves, the more they have firsthand experience, the more I grab a ball from you and you hit me and I learn how to get the ball next time so you don't hit me, and you learn what you can do next time so you don't need to hit me. That kind of firsthand experience doesn't happen when you're glued to a screen. you're kind of learning, every child watching the screen is getting exactly the same agenda. You're not bringing your own experience and interacting with the screen, so that you become much more remote controlled. So when I, you know, do research on Bratz play, I hear every child's playing the same way. That's not play. That's not being creative. So remote control childhood primes children to just want to be like everybody else and conform and expect and judge everybody, each other, by how well they're conforming. But you also end up with a situation where when children are remote controlled and they lose their controller, they don't know what to do. And we have that more and more where parents say, well, you know, I try to turn off the telly or the computer, but my kids just start fighting each other. Or how am I going to make dinner if they're not watching television? You know, I'm a single parent, and I need to do it. I need to turn it on so I can do what I need to in the house. But the fact is, the more kids have screens, the more they're into the program world, the more they need them, and the less resources they develop otherwise. So remote-controlled childhood really undermines play, creativity, and learning long before we even think about the content, the sexual images they're getting, and the violent images. And this actually is from Australia, where I went to a classroom where the kids had lots and lots of media, and they were four, and they were just all starting school. And the teacher knew to sit at the table when she put out Play-Doh, because the kids would poke it and say, what does it do? As symbolized by the boy in the middle who's scratching his head, asking, what do I do? You know, kids used to try to figure out what it does. I mean, they're used to the zap, zap, zap of the screen, and the Play-Doh just sits there. And it doesn't give them messages about you fight with it, or you do this with it, or you do that with it. I've come to call what I'm talking about problem-solving deficit disorder. The fact that when a child is building with blocks, they start stacking them and they fall over and they think, what can I do to make it go taller? And they discover if they line all the blocks up really carefully, it can go taller. They've learned something new about blocks, and they use what they've learned to build again, and this time it falls over when it's a little taller, and now they discover if I put the big blocks at the bottom and the little ones at the top, so now they're paying attention to geometry, not just, you know, organization. And so that whole approach to problem solving and problem finding and problem solving, I think, is the way we learn. The letter B, you need to figure out how it works. And it needs to be an interesting problem to solve. You start looking everywhere for the B's and the squiggles, and you suddenly realize it goes buh when it's their ball, buh when it's their baby. And so being a problem solver is the best thing we can do for kids to help them become lifelong learners. And what I've talked about so far is undermining that. I'm convinced that some of the children who have ADD, it's made worse by them having problem-solving deficit disorder. They're the kids where parents often need screens the most to get them to attend, but it prevents them from learning other ways to do it. But then we often end up blaming children when they do what makes perfect sense. And now I want to bring the content back in. So one, they're remote controlled, but now when they're remote controlled around sexy issues and appearance issues and violence issues, the plot thickens. One of the stories in the book, So Sexy, So Soon, is about a five-year-old, a boy, who says to a girl, I want to have sex with you. The parent didn't hear it. The teacher didn't hear it. The child goes home to the parent. The parents come in hysterical. They're about to suspend the child from school. Suspensions are growing hugely in the U.S. at this point, starting with preschoolers, more and more suspensions. And the rule at the school was you had to go to the school counselor before you could be suspended. And this boy went to the counselor, and she said, what did you want to do to Jenny? And he burst into tears for the first time, and he said, I like her. I wanted to give her a hug. So there's a few important messages there. One, when I taught young children, you know, a fair number of years ago, hugging, you know, kissing, and I think they said a kiss as well. Five-year-olds didn't say they wanted to kiss each other when they liked each other. So there were ways in which they were learning stuff from the culture. But there was also the meaning he was making from it, which is different from adult meanings. And the adults hear it and interpret it in an adult way, and we need to think about how to take a child's point of view when we're thinking about these issues. But he was doing something that made perfect sense given what he had been exposed to and then getting blamed for it. He liked this girl, he wanted to play with her, and he learned what you do when you like somebody. That's the message he was getting from the culture. Here's another example of how they think differently from adults. A teacher with five-year-olds goes to, has the kids have a little journal where they put something in it every day and try to write letters and talk about it. And she went up to him and said, "Tell me about your picture." And he said, "It's a professional wrestling girl with big boobies." And the teacher's first thought was, "I better get rid of this. You know, we'll take it out of your book and you'll take it home. This is not something for school." But she was a good teacher. And she said, "Well, what do you know about professional wrestling girls?" And he said, "I saw it last night with my big brother. He was babysitting. It's a secret." And I told this teacher she should be really, really heartened that since he couldn't tell his parents and clearly he was upset about it and trying to figure it out, that he had come to her. And by age 7, children would know a secret means you can't tell the teacher either. But at 4 and 5, they're not so consistent in their thinking. So he actually felt, you know, it could talk to the teacher about it. And she said, you know, so she could say, "So, you know, how come your brother decided to watch it and how come your parents don't know?" And they could start having a whole conversation. And the single most important lesson I want to leave you with today, and I'll come back to it, but I want to start now, is connecting with kids around these issues. The fact he felt safe enough to go to his teacher to see how she reacted. If she said, "Put it in your cubby and take it home, it's not for school," he may never have talked to an adult again as the issues get bigger and bigger as he gets older. Finding ways to connect with kids around what's going on becomes really, really important. So then it's teaching children harmful lessons. We know that, for instance, messages about bodies and eating disorders, and clinics told me that they're seeing younger children, more younger children and girls, and beginning to see some boys with eating disorders. The mother of a four-year-old recently said to me, she said to her daughter, without even thinking she was encouraging healthy eating, her daughter wanted another cookie, and the mother said, "Oh, let's not have any more cookies, let's have this healthy thing, because we don't want to get fat." And the daughter interpreted eating makes you fat. She didn't get the whole idea. And she doesn't want to eat now. But the story in the book is about a 7-year-old who starts crying in the bathtub, and the mother said, "What's wrong?" And she says, I'm fat. I need to go on a diet. And you know, the mother was completely distraught. And hopefully I'll come back a little bit to talk about how the mother dealt with it. But then it teaches children to treat themselves and others as objects. How they look, what they buy, determines their value. It's how they judge themselves. It's how they judge others. Girls judge each other that way. Boys judge girls that way. For boys, it's how tough and macho and ready to fight they are. Do they, you know, if boys cry, they're sissies. You know, so that it's a very narrow range of behavior for both, and it's objectified. It doesn't humanize them, it dehumanizes them. Even outside on the climbing structure, where a mother recently told me of her daughter at age 6 was climbing on the climbing structure in the play yard. And there were several other kids there. Her daughter's overweight. A boy on the jungle gym said, "You're going to break it," when she climbed on. And all the kids there started chanting, "You're going to break it, you're going to break it, you're going to break it." And she started crying and walked off. And nobody went to help her. And now she doesn't want to go to school. She was refusing to go to school. She's developing a school phobia. So then, healthy sexual development is undermined. And I spent a long time, this book was really hard to write. It's much harder to write about sex than violence. Violence is so much, we can say to children, violence, it's bad. It's bad to hurt each other. We need to find a way to solve our problem. So, you know, that doesn't involve hurting. And the world may be doing a bad job with it, but at least in our own little settings, we can try to promote that. And sex isn't bad, and what we're talking about with young children isn't really sex. It ends up being linked to sex. It's sexiness and sexualization. It's an objectification that's, you know, the appearance and isolation. And the objectification of sex, as I was writing the book, I realized the heart of the issue we need to think about is when children are young, what we want them to learn about, and you heard about this morning too, is how to become caring, connected people who can have relationships. We want them to be able to grow up, to have caring, connected relationships in which sex is a part. To do that, when they're young, they need to learn how to have relationships, not how to be sexy. To have relationships, they need to have firsthand experience, not be glued to the screen. To have relationships, they need to have lots of interactions with each other, not have a TV set in their own room the way 40% of American children do. We need to figure out ways to get kids interacting again and learning about relationships, not as they do in the U.S. is often just cancel recess because kids are hurting each other on the playground. So what's happening is there's an objectification of sex, not, you know, it's kind of moving it out of a connection to relationship. And to me, it's epitomized by something like Cosmo Girl magazine, where here's instructions on 5 new hot kisses so the boy will like you, without one mention of relationship. And that's happening over and over and over again for kids. So it's undermining caring, connected relationships. And that means it's easier for kids to hurt each other. It's easier for me to just hit you over the head when you grab the ball for me instead of working it out. Kids need to be problem solvers to solve their conflicts if they have PSDD and then they have CDD, compassion deficit disorder. It becomes really hard for them to have care and connected relationships. And here's an example just where the U.S. banned tag because kids were hurting each other. I would argue if kids are hurting each other, when they get inside and are supposed to be doing their schoolwork, they're going to be thinking about relationship stuff. They're not going to focus on the schoolwork if we don't help them with relationships. Their academic learning is going to be impaired as well. So then another thing going on is age compression. Blurring of boundaries between children and adults. We see, you know, women are supposed to look like girls. Girls are supposed to look like women. It's harder for us to treat children as children or children to be children. Here's an example from an ad, where it's very confusing. Who's the child? I've mentioned premature adolescent rebellions, which makes it harder for adults to do their job. As teachers, we lose our authority sooner. Kids just put up with us at best, often, rather than seeing us as caring people who are there to help and guide them, because we stand in the way of what the pop culture is teaching, the pop culture box as being cool and successful, and often they're right. So that's why we need to know about the pop culture box if we're gonna deal with it. So, okay, what can we do? Hopefully things will go uphill from there. That's the end of that. We can help children connect the boxes. We can try to make the family societal culture box as big as possible. That means really think about the issues we're working on and how to consciously help kids integrate them into the more pop culture world. We can make the pop culture world be as little as possible. And this means in your job, helping parents to, you know, to limit media exposure, helping parents to expand the role. The guide I showed you this morning, we also do a guide called a media action guide, which helps parents think about how to deal with media, which you can download and use pieces of or all of. But then we have to connect the boxes. And by connecting the boxes, my favorite example of my experience as a parent of connecting the boxes, I have a son who is a first post-deregulation generation child. He's now in his middle 20s. He was two when deregulation happened, so the biggest toy in his early years was He-Man. But when he was in 6 years old and in first grade, the Ninja Turtle movie was coming out. And the expert in his class for Ninja Turtles invited him to go to the opening. And it was the best thing that had ever happened to my son in his whole life. And we were going away that weekend. Yay. So my son couldn't go with his friend, and he was miserable. And I taught, we hadn't gone to movies like that before. And I said to him, you know, what can we do to help you feel better, as he's crying in despair? And he said, go next week with JP, the expert. We were going to visit his grandparents the weekend of the opening. So he went to school Monday, and every other boy in his class had seen the movie. And we agreed we would go the next weekend, and we invited JP. And it was an example of saying no had worked up till then, but saying no would have been worse than not saying no at this point. And it's how do we gradually let the culture in, the pop culture in. So we went to the movie, we came out. The woman I had done a lot of this work with, Nancy Carlson Page, knew we were going, and she called up afterwards. And she said, Eli, how was the movie? And he said, we came out and my mom said she had a stomach ache and couldn't eat dinner. But I loved it. And Nancy could say, so what gave your mom a stomach ache? And he could talk about, well, she said all they did was fight, and she said they did this. He had that voice in his head. And then she said, and what did you love about it? And he could talk about that too. And we want kids to have a voice, so we can connect with them. It's not just telling them to, I didn't want him to have a stomach ache too. I wasn't, you know, the idea is he had both boxes. We were working on both. We could talk about what else could they have done. Let's think about what the movie could have been so I didn't have to get a stomach ache. And we could talk about that. It helped him empathize with me. It helped him really learn both things. And it wasn't like at that point we were then in complete agreement. It was an ongoing process throughout his childhood. And I think we need to have discussions like that. We need to stop blaming children. We need to stop blaming parents. I've seen secret memos from the industry that basically say when something you do is criticized, just say, it's, you know that it's not your job to decide what's appropriate. Parents know their children best. And if they didn't buy it, you wouldn't make it. Does that make sense to you? For those of you who are parents, did your kids ever get something you didn't want them to have? Did you ever try to protect them from something that got in anyway? Because industry works to then sabotage you in your every effort. Okay, so we need to get beyond the just say no approach. It doesn't mean we never say no, but no is a complicated process. And if we just say no, we cut ourselves off from connecting the boxes. Kids stop coming to us. If we just say no, they begin to have adolescent rebellion sooner. They're not, you know, they just see adults as not understanding them and not caring about what's important to them. So we need to find ways to connect. It doesn't mean we always say yes, but when we say no, there's a process involved where we learn from them and they learn from us. We want to protect children as much as possible from exposure. And I think, here's an example of how schools can help parents. This was a school where the teacher had a conversation. Do you have rules in your house about what TVs, what you can watch and what you can't watch? And then the kids made little pictures of what the rules were. But when a child said, no violence, the teacher said, well, why do you think parents have that rule? Your parents have that rule. And he said, one time I snuck and I got really scared, but I couldn't tell. So another child said, this one I chose because I was coming here, no watching TV on sunny days. I thought that's probably not a very good rule here, but but based on what we heard this morning about going out in the rain, maybe it should be no TV on rainy days. So then just doing media, doing consumer education. This, I've done it with all ages, but this was my favorite, where we really talked to kids. This one was, tell me a toy where the ad disappointed you, where the ad looked like it'd be exciting and it wasn't. And this one, I got the G.I. Joe aircraft carrier and it stinks. On the commercial, it held 18 jets and the superstructure, blah, blah. Liars. Why did they have to lie so much? Why couldn't they lie only a little? Why couldn't they make it a little more realistic instead of a stupid piece of junk? And I had many conversations like this with my son. He got his first action figure from his grandparents. He got on the plane and the arm fell off. And he started crying. He was about four. And I thought, what can I do? I said, those mean people at the factory, they made it look like it was going to be so much fun in the box, but it was a piece of junk. It just broke as soon as you used it. He's going, those mean people. And a week later, he says, can I get another one of those? And I said, but remember what happened. And he said, now that I know what happened, I won't feel so bad. So, my son became a very good arguer. But he was getting those voices in his head. I'd be disappointed when he said it on the one hand. On the other hand, he felt strong enough. He was developing a voice himself, and I was listening and learning from it. And that we need to help kids do that. We can work to combat PSDD. By helping kids become good players. Here's an example of the teacher with the Play-Doh. It doesn't always work this magically, but she was sitting there and she said, look, I made a ball. And another child said, oh, I made a ball. And another child said, I made a ball. And then a child said, I made a big ball. And another said, I made a little ball. And they started lining them up. It became a great math lesson. Can you make it the size of mine? And what I love about this, the boy in the middle in the back suddenly said, look, I made meatballs. And what I love about that developmentally is they started out like two-year-olds poking something to see, what does it do? Just poking it. They ended up like four-year-olds using Play-Doh to represent making one thing stand for something else, which is developmentally where four-year-olds should be with Play-Doh. So that idea that they are educable, even though they may have needs, that we really can make a difference is important to remember. Here's the group I mentioned to you this morning, Teachers Resisting Unhealthy Children's Entertainment, that does the toy guide, the media guide, and we're now working on an infant toddler guide because of all the electronic toys for infants and toddlers. Then we need to work to combat compassion deficit disorder by helping kids develop caring, connected relationships. And one of my favorite examples of that was a teacher who ended up with her kids. The girls started laughing at a picture of a fat woman, a fat child in a book, and she got really upset about it. And she ended up doing a problem story with them, which she often did around issues that came up. She started a story. She started writing a book with the story about this little girl who was overweight and she was outside playing and someone started teasing her this way and that way. And you see her start to cry. What could you do to help her? And all the kids make their pictures and she helps them write what they would do. And then they have a meeting where they talk about all the different solutions and what words you could use as a way of helping them empathize instead of just saying it's bad. You shouldn't laugh at her, you shouldn't do this, and just criticizing their behavior. She really tried to help them so that next time they see a child being bullied or teased on the playground, they're much more likely to intervene. Another one is, here's the conversation of crying in the bathtub, which to me illustrates the kinds of conversations we won't always have. They're really hard, but we should aim for it. The mother, so you're not happy how you look. You think a diet will help you look better. Yes, it will. Gemma's on a diet with her mother. Well, what do you know about diets? This is the 7-year-old. A diet is when you only eat a little. I eat too much. You shouldn't let me. And that's like a 7-year-old attributing all power to the grown-up. It's the grown-up's fault. So you want me to help you be on a diet, to eat less food at every meal. Notice how the mother's not saying, no, you're wrong. This is the right answer. Yes, I want to be pretty. Sweetie, it sounds like you think if you can eat less, you'll be prettier. How does that work? You know, you get skinny when you eat less. That's prettier, sexier. So you want to get skinnier because that will make you sexy. What do you know about sexy? Sexy is when you're pretty, so boys like you. You run around and they try to catch you. They even kiss you. That happens with Isabel. And I've heard of more and more classrooms where girls and boys on the playground play dating. And they have fights over, boys have fights over the, which girl they want to be, who's the girl who's been sexualized, the one they want to be their date. But staying connected with children is what I'm really talking about. Safe channels of communication, give and take conversations, taking the lead from children. What we want to do in terms of the, you know, breaking down the stereotypes, what's happening now is I tend to think of this bell curve of behaviors for girls and boys, and right now there's the least overlap possible. You even need, you know, pink diapers for girls, nappies, and blue nappies for boys. Or, you know, that everything is gender divided in a way it never was before, that there's just, you know, there's this very little overlap. What I would like to see is having more. It doesn't mean boys and girls are going to be exactly the same, but there's a lot of skills and interests they all should be developing. My favorite example of this is recently a teacher shared with me a thematic. The girls were obsessed with princesses. And Disney has been a genius at figuring out how to make things be a little less offensive than things parents are worried about, like Bratz dolls, and use parents' love of Disney and their remembrances of princesses, which were very stereotyped in their own right. Disney has turned it into the biggest marketing phenomenon of anybody, and they're genius how they've done it. And now teachers in the state, are Disney princesses popular among girls here? Okay, so this teacher, the girls, when they talk, they always would have discussions, what should we turn the dramatic play area into? And girls said, princesses. And immediately they wanted it to be Disney. So she started a whole curriculum where she read books about princesses that were not stereotyped. And she ended up with the kids. They started making pictures of princesses and princes. They started studying princes. They started talking about all the things they could do. They started writing books. They call one 26, after they read the book, we decided to create their own book using the 25 kids in our class, 25 princes and princesses, and each one started describing the special things about them and who they were. They had a royal feast where they dressed up as princes and princesses, and they made food and they had a banquet. So the teacher's idea was, how can you take this narrow stereotype that's focused totally on appearance and sexiness and turn it into kind of a rich curriculum that really expanded the stereotypes, and that's what we need to do. And lastly, we need to think about age-appropriate sex education, and that will vary from, you know, from place to place what it means, but what I think of sex education is starting long before sex is the topic of discussion. It's about relationships. It's kind of social, emotional education where you're really talking about relationships and working on problems kids are having with each other, and that gradually, you know, sex issues come in. Many of the schools I've worked with at fifth and sixth grade talk about it more, and in fact, the teacher I've worked with most came to me a few years ago, which was the ultimate reason for my deciding I had to write So Sexy So Soon, which was she had taught sex education for years, and in the course of meeting with the boys in fifth and sixth grade to talk about sex, the actual reproduction issues, boys started talking about pornography. And it turned out almost all the boys in that class 5 years ago had seen pornography. And the figures in the US now are huge, the number of boys by age 12 who have seen pornography. And I'm sure that's also a global issue. So thinking about how do we counteract that becomes important. I'm just going to jump to the last thing here. If you go to the website for my book, So Sexy, So Soon, there's resources, there's books to use, there's websites to go to. It's packed with material that will help you if you want to take on the issue. I want to end with a story that has to do with pornography. And that is, my favorite story in the book came from two parents who were doing an amazing job of staying connected to their son. And the way they tell the story, when their son was four, they had a family friend who had a baby. And they already had a two-year-old sibling, but he was too young to ask the question when he was two. But at four, he said, how did the baby get in the mommy's tummy? And the mother said, the father puts the seed in the mother's tummy, and he said, oh, and he walked away. And that was this boy's style in many ways. You know, kids have different styles, just walking away. He came back 6 months later, and he said, how does the dad put the seed in the mother's tummy? And they said, the father takes his penis and puts it in the mother's vagina and puts the seed in that way. And he said, oh, and he walked away. About a year later, he came back looking troubled and said, I really, really want to be a dad when I grow up, but I can't do that thing with my penis. So he clearly had been thinking about it. And the father answered this one, and I thought the answer was just amazingly good. That's why these parents did better than any other parents I've ever met. He said, I know, that's what children your age always think. It sounds really, really weird. But when you grow up and you really love somebody, it can feel really good. And he said, oh, and he walked away. And notice how the father focused on relationship, which is what I'm telling you is so important to reconnect to. So then the son comes home when he's 7 and says, is sexy sex? And the parents said, what do you mean? And he said, well, all the boys say Hannah's sexy and they want her to be their girlfriend. And so he was trying to figure out, were they trying to have sex with her? What did it mean? And they explained, and then when he was 8, he came home and said, I saw something at Joey's house that I think will make you mad. And they said, what? And he said, I saw sex on the computer. And it was pornography that he saw. And they, you know, talked to him about it. The father said that time he didn't know how to respond, and you don't always know how to respond, and you can say, let's talk about that tomorrow. You know, I need to think about it. Or you can say, gee, you know what I said yesterday? I've been thinking about it. I really wanted to talk about it this way. So this is hard stuff. There's no formulas. And it never happens in exactly the same way. So, you know, the way it comes up. But this father focused on the peer pressure. The boy had said, I kind of didn't want to look, but I didn't know what else to do. So that's what the father focused on. First of all, let's think about what you could have done if you didn't want to see it. I want to leave you with that story. Because to me, he came home when he was upset and scared, you know, worried about something, and he knew he could go to his parents and ask about it. When we start being connected when kids are young with whatever, and when they feel we're not going to get hysterical, even if we are inside, we're not going to be punitive, we're not going to get upset, they can talk to us about whatever they want to, then when more serious things start happening, we can be connected. And my favorite example of that with my son, where it led, when he was finishing secondary school and going to the prom, which we have, it's different from your proms, I think. It was the big dance at the end of the year. I said, what are you doing afterwards? And he looked a little sheepish. He said, going to Henry's house, his parents' house in the country. I said, do they know? He said, no. I said, well, let me tell you why I'm worried about it. And eventually he agreed we could invite Henry over for dinner and talk about it, because I was worried about Henry's parents not knowing. And before he came to dinner, my son said, Henry's parents know now. And I'm sure my son talked to him after we talked about all the potential problems. But, you know, it's that most kids would not have said that, but he knew, I mean, and I wasn't going to go to Henry's parents. He knew that too, but I felt responsible to try to figure out a way to make it safe. So that idea of staying connected pays off. And I think, again, as professionals, there are ways that we have a real responsibility to start learning better how to take it on. We don't know all the answers.